welcome again to our conference, Josh Tolley.
Does this come off?
Yeah.
Perfect. I have ADD, so I can't stand still.
It is great to be here again. I remember I did this last year to a little bit of arm twisting. I have a really busy schedule. Matter of fact, I have to get off of the stage in about 10, 12 minutes because I have to host a show. But I love doing this. And the reason I love doing this is because of the importance that counties have. If you've noticed, the economy has changed since you were kids. And we're to this point now where we have to realize in counties, we have to make some decisions. We either have to export our products and services or import customers. Because the model that used to work doesn't work anymore. We used to live in a world where, you know, you go to small towns because the prices would be cheaper. I remember my mother lived in Madison, my dad lived in Adams Friendship area, and things were always cheaper in Adams because it was small town America. Well, that's changed. The reason that changed is because now we have a global economy, e-commerce. The guy who owns your building in a small county actually lives in Chicago, so you're actually paying a mortgage to pay his bills in Chicago as opposed to the bills in your county, so things are changing. And because of that, we're seeing a lot of counties dying. We are. Matter of fact, out of the 3,600 counties and some change in America, there's only about two dozen of them that are actually experiencing growth. That's it. And the largest factor to a growing county is obviously economics. If there's no jobs, people leave. If there's no business opportunities, businesses don't come. So when you have a board that takes the effort and the time to put together something like this, that's amazing, and that's what I love to be a part of. So how many of you either own or are part of what would be considered a small business in America, 50 million or less? Okay, that's a lot of you. And because of you, you are the economic engine that the rest of the country needs to continue to grow. Because if you've noticed, the bigger companies are what, coming or going? Going. So you need to grow. So what I want you to do today is I want you to think to yourself, what is the strategy behind this? Don't just think, okay, I'm here at another conference, because I did that for years. I went from conference to conference, and I got the goodie bag, and I sat there for a while, and maybe, you know, met up with some friends for lunch. But overall, nothing really changed, nothing really happened. And what I loved about last year, we did do something. We said, okay, we're going to put together a class. It lasted 10 months. And in that 10-month process, we're going to take businesses right out of Monroe County, meet with them on a monthly basis, and yes, Steve, I actually did feel like I lived here for a while. And we actually transitioned some of the thought processes, the strategy, the marketing, the advertising, the branding. And it's not enough anymore just to hang your shingle, think you have a good product or service, and that's enough to cut it. I'm sorry, you won't. How many of you know that it takes 10% growth a year just to maintain zero actual growth? Right? And because of that, we're seeing a lot of businesses shrink because this is what happens. Somebody gets into business, right? And they say, man, I used to make $10 an hour. Now I'm in business, I might be making $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 a year. Well, 10 years go by, that's actually worth half of what it used to be. So then you hear, oh man, I'm working twice as hard, but I'm not making as much. I don't know why that is. Well, that's why that is. So your business has to have a 10% growth plan every year or you're going backwards. Do you have that? If not, think about how you're going to get that by the end of the day. You also have to realize that your employees, if you hire anybody, your employees have changed too. See, 10, 20 years ago, employees were employees for the long haul. Now, the average career lasts less than 4 years. And newsflash, they don't want to work for you. And I know that comes as a shock, but I've actually spoken at some SHRM events. Any SHRM members in here? And there's this, like, almost lie that we all want to believe, that our employees want to be there, and they believe we want them there too, right? But the reality is, if you could replace them with a robot for cheaper, you would. And they're happier Friday afternoon than they are Monday morning. So because of that, leadership has actually changed. It has. No longer can we use the leadership books written in the 90s about peak-to-peak leadership and, you know, share the dream and the vision, get them on board. Then cut it. Because they're going home and they're looking online for the next job to replace you. Your employees are actually becoming your active competition if you think about it. And because we don't even change that, we still think, okay, I don't have to change since 1990s. Because of that, we're losing good employees. Turnover has become a massive expense for a lot of companies now. 30 years ago, not so much. 30 years ago, your employees would be there for a pension. Well, now you can't offer one, they know that. So they're not gonna stick around. So you have to change how you develop your leadership. You also have to develop multiple streams of income as opposed to whatever you just used to do. John Hancock Insurance, for example. They make more money selling chickens than insurance now. Because they knew you cannot be a business that focuses on one product or service. You just can't be. That was 1960s, it's dead. So you have to start looking for other opportunities, other growth opportunities. That's where the county comes in. See, I do this a lot. And I do it for different groups. Sometimes I do it for religious organizations, sometimes I do it for states. But one thing that I've learned over doing this for now 15 years is the quicker you can create a culture, which a community is a culture, the quicker you can create a culture, the quicker you can actually get to real economic growth as opposed to just opening up a business. So for example, the immigrant culture in this country, the Muslim business owners, right? Great example, to be honest. A Muslim business owner will spend a dollar that is spent in his business 14 times in the Muslim community before it leaves. You know how many times we, average Native Americans, do that? Zero. Zero. We put zero thought into where we're going to spend that dollar. None. And then we wonder why immigrants coming into this country have more successful businesses than we do. Because they should have more successful businesses than we have. Because we don't think about where we spend the dollar. We think, well, Walmart is having a sale, or Bob's, you know, whoever. And all we do is value price as opposed to purpose. When you value price as opposed to purpose, then don't expect your customers to be any different than you. Does that make sense? Like, we're always saying, oh, how do I grow my business? How do I get more markup? How do I generate revenue? What are you doing? Would you go for something cheaper? Mm-hmm. Would you pay employees less? Mm-hmm. So why do we expect anything different? The same is true with sales. You need to start asking yourself, am I in sales? Short answer is all of you are, right? Doesn't matter what you sell. Doesn't matter if you're a stay-at-home mom, you're selling lessons. Doesn't matter if you're a preacher, you're selling God, right? Everybody's in sales. But that too has changed. No longer can you use things like feel, felt, found, or always be closing, or assumption closes, or features, advantages, and benefits, or turnover closes. All those things are dead in the water, and there's a psychological reason for that. I just don't have time to get into it. But they're dead in the water too. So across the board, nationwide, sales are going like this. And instead of, you know, 5 out of 10, we're down to 3 out of 10, or 2 out of 10, or 1 out of 10. And if any of you have salespeople, you know that. So that has changed. So don't come here this week, or this weekend, don't come here today and think to yourself, okay, I'm just going to listen to a bunch of people and go home. That's not enough to do what we're here to do, which is economic development. You have to ask yourself, how do we develop more economy? And a perfect example of that is I gave a class to maybe 2 dozen MBAs, just MBAs. It was an MBA class. None of them even knew what the economy was. And I'm serious. I said, okay, how many of you can explain to me what the economy is? None of them raised their hand. They had no clue. They said, we didn't learn that. Well, what is this a conference for? Economic development. Your county economy. Did you know that in this county there are multiple economies? How many of us see the news, oh, well, the national economy is doing bad. Oh, so I must not start a business. Now's a bad time to expand. Now's a bad time to grow. Why? What's the national economy? Show it to me. And it's not even gross domestic product. It's really not. Because when you look at an economy, all an economy is an exchange of products or services for something that represents the monetary value of said product or service. That's it. Which means you can have a personal economy. If you get a raise and your neighbor gets fired, your economy looks pretty good. You can have a neighborhood economy. You can have a city economy. You can have a county economy. So if you're saying to yourselves, okay, well, then how do we develop this thing? Then you have to say, okay, then how do we as a county, one, create that culture like immigrants do? How do we create that in Monroe County? Two, how do I strategically grow my business, grow it, not sustain it, not just hang my shingle and hope to get customers? How do you actually strategically grow your business? Three, what sort of plan am I going to put in place to either A, export my product or service, or B, import customers? And as a county, you need to look at that.
Because again, 3,600 counties and only 24 or so actually have growth.
So you have to look at these things, and that's what I hope you get out of this. I really do. I hope that you today say to yourself, okay, enough. Enough just going to conferences. Enough just saying, okay, here's my product or service, and here hoping you're going to sell something. I actually taught a class, and Najee was in our class. One of the classes I taught was how to effectively use conferences. Like this. So maybe if I have time, I have 3 minutes. You never come to a conference or a networking event expecting to sell something. Just don't do it. One of the questions I'm asked the most is, Josh, how do I make most out of my BNI group or my Chamber of Commerce group or these events, trade shows? Well, I set up a booth and I'm here to sell, and it never works. I never sell anything. You know why? Because everybody's here selling. Nobody's buying. I mean, that's just the honest truth. If everybody in a room is here to sell, why would you expect anybody to buy? So you need to learn these tactics on how to use events like this to grow your business, because you can. It's just not the way most of us are taught. So the point is, in the little time I had, the point is, check your beliefs, check your past experiences at the door, and ask yourself, how am I going to learn whatever I need to learn today to accomplish just those things that Josh mentioned in 15 minutes? All right, I got to go do a show. I will be back later with a wonderful panel. Have a great time, guys.